About the deep resection margin, which has come out to be positive on frozen section.
So I am telling about the deep resection margin. You have to take deep resection margin if you have to revise from the one mucosal edge anterior to posterior, superior to inferior, all along the deep resection you have to do, not on the one side.
Okay.
It should be in a one piece only. It should not be like you have in the two pieces you are doing a deep resection margin. It should be a single specimen.
So okay. One point in
DK. Yeah, DK, please go ahead. DK has a comment to make.
So to take the deep margin, we can see all the mucosal margins all around. But for the deep margin, our left hand is very important in terms of palpation of the deep margin. And if it comes positive, despite that, then we have to remove, we have to take additional tissue and send it to frozen.
Yeah. So what we do is that we paint the entire surface. It's not possible to go back and find out from where you have taken the deep resection margin, frozen section. So what we do is we paint the entire surface from which the margin has come out to be positive, and then you re-resect it. You need to re-resect it till you have a clear margin. So it is very difficult to find out after you receive a frozen section report that where exactly the tumor tissue was taken, and you cannot revise that particular site. So you have to revise the entire margin. This is a take-home message for the residents that you need the clear deep resection margin. So this patient has been treated. We can unanimously agree that.
Just add one thing?
Yeah,
so if you have frozen section facility, it's good tool. You get more of, you know, kind of reconfirmation that everything is okay. But we did a study at TMH. It was done by Pankaj Sir's group. And it is actually very practical also, we have seen. And I also do not always send all my patients for frozen section. So if you have you have taken 1 centimeter margin all around, even in deep extent, like DK said, that you keep palpating the deeper this thing by using your left finger while you are removing. Any point, if you feel that you are able to palpate the tumor, change your plane. And then after resection, I do intraoperative grossing. I cut open the specimen. I measure my base. If it is more than 7 millimeter, it is unlikely that your frozen section is going to help. And this we have studied, we have found this figure of 7 millimeter, and it is quite accurate, because if you have taken 1 centimeter margin, the hardly even if you take 1 or 2 millimeter submucosal spread, so that will also compensate your 5 millimeter margin. Even if you consider shrinkage, it's about 30% in case of oral cancer. So yes, you have frozen section, take it. But if you don't have frozen section, your technical listening staff is not available for such small lesion, it's not must that you will, you know, postpone your surgery just because you don't have frozen section. So okay. I do not always necessarily send my specimen for frozen section. If I am very good all around 1 centimeter, I do not send.
Okay. So should we...
I want to add, frozen section is always not the answer. If the margin has become positive, or close, if you see that in the frozen section, then it's not necessary that our revision is going to have benefit in the survival. So your HP report, maybe you may feel it is free because you have taken an extra margin, but that may not always correlate to the survival benefit.
Okay, so just another question, Amit. Where do you take your margins from? Do you take the margins, frozen section from the specimen? Is it a specimen driven, or you take it from the patient?
Always better to do from the specimen.
Okay, Shilpi?
Yes, always specimen driven. In fact, there was one study also, they have compared specimen versus patient versus, and they found that specimen is more accurate. So we have unanimously followed this.
And Saurabh, how often do you change your management or intraoperative management on the basis of frozen section?
Rarely. It's very rare that you have to change. Even for the larger tumor, you are pretty much sure that what your resection will be. I don't think so. It's very rare. It's very rare that you have to change your surgical resection. If intraoperatively sometime you think that it is just close to the midline the tumor is, and on during operation you have seen that it is crossing at the septum at some at one place during your deep resection on palpation, Maybe I will add the contralateral neck dissection in that case. That's the only thing. I don't think so. I will my decision really change.
Okay. So there's a meta-analysis by Amit et al., which just as Shilpi said, the specimen-driven margins are more accurate. They tell you about the completeness of the dissection more rather than a patient-driven. But we always take margin from the. Thank you. I always take margin from the patient side only, and very rarely do we have to change the management, as Saurabh said. So Ravi has told me to be very fast and very quick. So this patient, we all agree that we'll do a
Vipin, I mean, you take patient this thing margin, or who? All of us, we take a specimen.
Please say that again. You will not order.
You said na, specimen driven is better, but we take from the patients. We never take from the patients. No? We specimen, we excise the specimen, we send it for frozen, and they check it is a specimen.
No,
it's specimen driven.
No, see, we all read the same literature. We all read the same books, but we still have our own ways of dealing.
Okay, you meant to say, okay, you have been.
I personally. It's not that you should.
Yes,
but yes. There are two school of thoughts. People take it from patient also. People take it from specimen also. So in this particular meta-analysis, the specimen-driven they were more representative of completeness of the section. And in these cases, the final histopathology correlates better with the frozen. And you will not have to change the management when you are. You are less likely to change the management when you take the frozen from specimen. This is the conclusion of this meta-analysis. So it has nothing to do. I'll continue with my practice and you'll continue with yours, but this is what the literature says. Okay. So very quickly, we'll go to the, at least we are able to do another case. I'll just show you. This was an early case of oral cancer. So I'll go to the next case. Can you have slide? Okay, so Dr. Nitin is presenting the next case and will be very quick.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. He is a 35-year-old male, resident of Meerut, presented to OPD with complaint of growth over left side of tongue since 6 months. Growth was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, associated with pain and bleeding and halitosis. On examination, mouth opening is 2.5 finger breadth, orodental hygiene is poor, tongue protrusion is restricted, a single 4x3 cm infiltrative growth with irregular margins, inverted edges present on left lateral border of the tongue and floor of mouth, extending anteriorly 2 cm behind the tip of the tongue, posteriorly till second premolar and inferiorly involving ventral surface of the tongue and floor of mouth. Growth is tender and bleed to touch. On neck examination, there is a single 2x2 cm lymph node, hard and fixed, palpable at left level 2. Now I would request sir to further.
So this is a local advanced cancer. So my first question is to DK. So what is your investigation of choice for this? Why the slide is not moving? The slide needs to move. So DK, what is the imaging modality of which is optimal for staging and treatment planning for this patient?
I think an MRI of the primary and the neck, and I would prefer a distant imaging both in this patient. So maybe a NCCT chest or a PET scan.
So which one are you want to go for? Like CT or that is a separate investigation, or a CT scan is fine.
So, if in this patient, I think a CCT head, neck, and chest should be okay. I would prefer a CCT head, neck, chest.
So, Dr. Rathore, sir.
Hello, yes, please.
Sir, how would you evaluate this patient, sir?
Actually, this patient is near the bony structures. So, first thing is that we have to rule out that what the mandibulectomy we have to do. So I think in this thing, this condition, a CT scan is preferable is to the MRI or any other thing, and along with the thorax CT. A thorax CT will have two advantages because it will have a long surgery, means a debilitating surgery. So we have to see whether any vascular problem is also there, and we have to evaluate this patient for reconstructive part also. So we have to do Allen test and so many things we have to do. So this is a part of examination of this patient. And my final decision is a CT scan here should be preferred.
Okay. So CT scan, sir, say a CT scan of the primary neck and the chest also, sir?
Chest also. Yes, thorax. Yes.
Okay. Dr. Akshit?
Yes, sir.
It's the same?
I would... If you give me a choice, I'll still prefer doing a MRI, and I will ask for NCCT thorax additionally. But I'm fine with CCT head neck thorax also.
We are happy with CT scan, DK wants and DK is for CT, Dr. Rathore is for CT, Shilpi and Saurabh.
MRI.
So one more thing I would like to ask, whether it is just reaching the GBS and bone or it is grossly sitting over the mandible. Because if it is just abutting, it's unlikely that there will be some bone erosion, and I would still go for MRI. And even if there is a doubt in this thing, MRI is also good for marrow invasion and all.
So, MRI has good sensitivity for bone.
Yeah, so I'm still comfortable with MRI because I would like to see, because it's a locally advanced tumor. I would like to see that is there anything which is grossly going on to the opposite side, to what extent, whether it is anterior, middle, or posterior, I will still prefer MRI.
Can you see the MRI? I have been given final ultimatum by Ravi, and we have 2 minutes. So I'll just, this is the MRI of this patient. So, better way to surgery.
Yeah, so it is operable for surgery. It is not crossing midline, though clinically it was looking, kind of a bulky lesion, but here it appears to be in first section, it appears to be slightly kind of a not that big, but in the opposite, it is involving the floor of mouth. It is abutting the bone, but it is not grossly infiltrating the marrow.
Yes.
So I will not order a CT scan, kind of just so for the bone.
No paramandibular spread along the lingual part as well, as it is above the mylohyoid line.
Saurabh, which operation will you do in this patient?
So examination is very important. In the MRI, it is looking like it is abutting the mandible. If there is a mucosa is there in between mandible and the floor of mouth extension, then I can do the pull through also in this case. But if it is very much close to the mandible, I will go with a marginal mandibulectomy and glossectomy. And I will do a bilateral neck dissection here and a pre-flap reconstruction with the soft tissue.
Okay. At least I have one panelist who will take through, and why is exactly the same what we did. I'll just show you the especially that in the content from the slide.
So VPN time is already up.
Sir, one minute, sir. 1 minute. Last minute, sir.
Okay.
Minutes. So this is incision. This is incision we used, and we used a midline incision and then did a bilateral neck dissection with marginal manipulation. You can see in the this intraoperative picture, and this is the surgical specimen. Next slide, can you show? And we reconstructed it with a radial free forearm flap, and this is the post-op picture of this patient around 10 days after the surgery. And this patient is still under follow-up. So my last question is to Dr. Shilpi. Dr. Shilpi, how will you follow up this patient? Surveillance.
So surveillance he will require adjuvant therapy based on histopathology, radiation plus minus chemotherapy. And then we will do first examination at 2 months or 3 months. Then for 2 years, I will do regular examination at 3 monthly interval. In between, if there is any patient specific complaints, any symptoms, and then after 2 years, I will increase to 6 months, and then after 5 years, yearly follow-up.
Yeah, so that is very important. You need to follow up these patients because they continue to have some problems, and then you need to evaluate these patients for recurrence or any second primary or distal metastasis. So with this, I thank you all for your participation and your academic contribution to the AOI. And it was indeed a pleasure to moderate the panel, and thank you so much. I hand over the mic to Dr. Ravi. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I thank the moderator and the panelists for this session on oral cancer. I don't think there is any time to take up any questions. So I thank everybody for participating. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Vipin, for moderating an excellent panel discussion on oral cancer. And thank you, Dr. Arunav Chakravarti, also for moderating the session. I now invite Dr. Evan Mathur to kindly give certificates to the moderator, Dr. Vipin Arora, and the panelist, Dr. Deepak.
So I will announce the team for the quiz, which have been selected for the main round. And Dr. Manish Munjal has given me the list. There's a team from AIMS, Dr. Anupam and Dr. Abhimanyu. Dr. Anupam Kanodia and Dr. Abhimanyu from AIMS. Dr. Nitin Singh and Dr. Vashi Gupta from UCMS. Dr. Gautam P and Lita Justin from BMMC and Sardarjung Hospital. Dr. Sonali Malhotra and Dr. Deeksha Sharma from Lady Harding. And last, Dr. Dalandeep and Dr. Daffy La from Mulanagar. So we have 5 teams for the final rounds, and we'll be having the final round after the invited talk session. Thank you. So we have the next session of invited talk, and I would like to invite Dr. Alok Agrawal and Dr. Seema Munga to chair this session. Dr. Seema Munga, please.
First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Ravi Gohil and Dr. Ishwar Singh and the AOI team for getting me this honor. I'm Associate Professor AMT in Damia Munda from the Institute of Medical Sciences. It's been an honor to invite our first speaker, Dr. Avinash Pijlani. He's Director of Madho Medical Center for AMT and Vertigo. He's a senior visiting consultant with DHLI Super Speciality Hospital. He has a long-standing experience in dealing with vertigo patients and is well-versed with the positional test and maneuvers for BPPV. His center is equipped with the VNG system and other modalities of diagnosis for vertigo. He has also developed a low-cost model depicting the three semicircular canals for better understanding of the mechanics of otoconial debris and BPPV. He has, having been invited to as a faculty to various national and international conferences. He is a past president of IMA Karol Bagh branch and also past governing body member of NES of India. He has many papers published, presented on topics like vestibular migraine, vestibular paroxysmal paroxysmia, and BPPV. Dr. Avinash Pijlani.
Thank you very much, Dr. Seema, for the kind words. And at the onset, let me thank the President, Dr. Ishwar Singh, and Secretary, Dr. Ravi Mehel, for giving me this opportunity to present a non-surgical talk in a conference full of all super speciality-wise ENT surgeries, which have been discussed till now. So, So what I'll be talking to you today is about the basics of how to be able to understand when a patient of vertigo comes to us and how to be able to arrive at a fairly reasonable diagnosis. Because what usually happens is that once a patient of vertigo comes to us, at least 10 years or so back, or even more, I mean, I used to get perplexed and think exactly what am I going to do with this patient. I think that happens to most of our ENT colleagues also, because it becomes a little difficult to arrive at a diagnosis. Anyhow, but the topic remains important, the disease remains important, because vertigo and dizziness are very common in the society, with a lifetime prevalence of almost around 30%. And after headache, vertigo and dizziness are the most common presenting symptoms. So who is to treat these patients? And of course, it is us otolaryngologists, because most of them are peripheral vestibular disorders and that belong to the inner ear. So I think the onus is on us to take care of it. So in the words of W.B. Matthews, way back in 1963, he quoted that there can be a few physicians who do not experience a slight decline in their spirits when they learn that the patient's complaint is giddiness. This frequently means that after exhaustive inquiry, it will still be not entirely clear what is it that the patient is suffering from or what he feels. Well, that's not entirely the case as things stand today. If you want to simplify your diagnosis, simplify your treatment, there are basically four different types of presentation, and there are six common disorders in vertigo. Firstly, you have acute vestibular syndrome comprising of either a vestibular neuritis, or as we nowadays call it, acute unilateral peripheral vestibulopathy, or it is a brainstem or a cerebellar infarct. Brainstem and cerebellar infarcts, they comprise only something like less than 10% of all cases presenting with an acute sudden onset vertigo, but nonetheless, they have to be delineated. Recurrent positional vertigo, the most common representative of this form of presentation is BPPV, followed by central positional vertigo. Then thirdly, you have a patient who comes to you with a chronic history of imbalance, long-standing. And here you have either a bilateral or unilateral vestibular insufficiency, or you have cerebellar ataxia and other neurological disorders. Fourthly, you have recurrent spontaneous vertigo, and the prototypes here are Meniere's disease and vestibular migraine. So we have four different types of presentations, six different types of disorders that you have to somehow diagnose. Now, how to evaluate your patient once the patient comes to you? I always say the most important thing is the history. History, 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 and history. If you're not been able to take a clear-cut history, I think most of the cases, at least I would fail to arrive at a diagnosis when I'm dealing with a patient of vertigo. So you have to take a good history, find out what is the type of vertigo the patient is suffering from, and secondly, what is the duration of the event. So this is followed by a good clinical examination looking for the type of nystagmus that the patient has presented with. So not to go into depth, there are four key questions in history. What is the principal presenting symptom? Patient says it's a rotating form of vertigo. First think in terms of acute vestibular neuritis. Postural imbalance, like as if he's on a boat trip or he gets a rocking sensation. The representative disorder is bilateral vestibulopathy. And there are patients who come with a very non-specific lightheadedness. And here you have to think of psychogenic disorders like a phobic postural vertigo. Now, number two, how long has the disorder been present? How long has he been suffering? Duration. So for this, I'll skip to the next slide. And here you can see from this over here that you can arrive at a differential diagnosis from the duration of the attack. Seconds to minutes, vestibular paroxysmia and benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. Lasting minutes to hours, you think of Meniere's disease or vestibular migraine. Then something that has been present for a few days now, think of vestibular neuritis. Then something that has been present for months to years, you think of persistent postural perceptual dizziness, that is triple PD, bilateral vestibulopathy, or a central vestibular vertigo. Thirdly, is there a significant past history? Has there been any incidence of vertigo or imbalance in the past? So number one, if there has been something in the past, anything that is not new may not be as bad. You know, like if it's a first episode, then it could be a stroke also. But if you have a past history, that means it's recurrent vertigo, need not be what can be perilous. Anyway, was the patient subjected to CT scan or MRI imaging? So if you already have that available and if it's normal, you're safe. The patient is also safe. Was an audiogram done? Sometimes patients present with vertigo and the vertigo is so intense that they just forget about, they don't mention any hearing loss. But if you have a clear-cut evidence in the form of an audiogram, there you are. Any associated symptoms like headache, hearing loss, dysarthria, diplopia, paresthesia? Well, all these are indicators that you should investigate more in depth. So a patient presents to you with the first ever attack of vertigo, acute vertigo, what is known as acute vestibular syndrome. He presents with not only vertigo, intense nausea, vomiting, and a sense of imbalance. Here, it comes to a timely diagnosis being very critical. As I previously said, you have to delineate the benign peripheral conditions from the serious brainstem or cerebellar posterior fossa strokes, because these can be potentially life-threatening and there are published accounts of misdiagnosis leading to death of the patient. So I'll come to a simple and quick clinical examination, bedside examination of the patient or once the patient walks into your clinic. In fact, the examination of the patient begins the moment the patient has walked into the clinic or you have gone to the bedside of the patient. Now, this is a video that shows you the Unterberger's test. This is a patient who presented to me on day two, and he has a left-sided vestibular neuritis, and see how he went leftwards when you did the Unterberger's test. Now, here's a patient who came to me around 10 to 12 days later. He's better. He only tends to fall to one side after a while. See here. Okay, quickly go to the next slide. So, HINTS basically stands for head impulse test, nystagmus, and test of skew deviation, and PLUS stands for the test for hearing. So we'll begin with the head impulse test. All you have to do is hold the head of the patient firmly between your hands and turn the head suddenly with a jerk to the right or to the left and ask the patient to keep concentrating on your nose. Normally, as you move the head to the right, the eyes move left and vice versa. But in a patient with vestibular neuritis or any other acute peripheral vestibular disorder. Now in this video, just watch. Now this is normal. As you move the patient's head to the right, the eyes move to the left. But when you turn the patient's head in the opposite direction, you can now the next particular sequence, you can see the saccadic eye movements. The patient makes a refixation saccade. So you saw the refixation saccade here. So this is a very reliable bedside test for assessing the VO or gain of the semicircular canals. And the exception being that if there's an infarction of the ICA that involves the labyrinth, and it's a very small infarct, even in this case, you may land up with a false positive head impulse test. Otherwise, it's a wonderful test. It can be easily done by the bedside. Now coming to the difference between the nystagmus and the peripheral and the central forms, all of you must be knowing it, so I'll just go through it a bit hurriedly. Peripheral nystagmus is usually horizontal or a horizontal torsional nystagmus, and it's more likely to be suppressed by fixation. It's a direction fixed nystagmus and it follows Alexander's and Ewald's laws. Central variety, you can have vertical or a torsional nystagmus, but you can also have a horizontal nystagmus. Presence of horizontal nystagmus does not exclude a central pathology. And for that matter, the maximum number of patients for central vertigo also will present to you with horizontal nystagmus. Vertical and torsional nystagmus are much rarer. It's less likely to be suppressed by fixation. It's direction changing, but can be fixed also. And it's less likely to follow the Alexander's and Ewald's laws. I'll just show you horizontal nystagmus in a patient of peripheral vestibulopathy. Here, this is without, this is with fixation. We're not covered the eyes of the patient, we're not made it dark. And you can observe the nystagmus beating to the right. So this is a left-sided disorder. And see, you can see the other side, the pupils are also dilated because we made it dark for the patient. And look at the intensity of the nystagmus. It increases once you have removed the fixation. If you don't have a VNG system, no problem. You can use what you call Frenzel's glasses. And Frenzel's glasses, if you get them imported, they turn out to be very expensive. What I did at the beginning of my career with Vertigo was that I went to an optician, just purchased the cheapest tough frame, fix in 16 to 18 diopter convex lenses in that, and just throw some light from outside. Works like wonders. So you can see the right beating nystagmus quite clearly in this. Not playing the whole video, don't want to waste time. Now direction changing nystagmus is always considered as an indicator for a central disorder. Look at both these videos simultaneously. As the patient looks to the right, you get a right beating nystagmus. As the patient looks to the left, you get a left beating nystagmus. Vertical nystagmus. Now, downbeating nystagmus usually occurs with flocular or paraflocular cerebellar lesions. And this is basically because, let me share with you that the anterior canal has the highest representation at the level of the vestibular nuclei. So, once you have a superior vestibular nerve involvement, the anterior canal is gone. So, that, you know, gets disinhibited. So, now the inhibitory pathways whatever is letting it happen, that is removed. That is why you get this downbeating nystagmus. And you can have it with CV junction lesions like Arnold-Chiari malformations, or in cases of multiple sclerosis plaques, or also in vertebrobacillar insufficiency. This is how downbeat nystagmus is. Upbeat nystagmus is less common, represents brainstem or cerebellar infarcts, but it's nonetheless a very strong indicator of CNS involvement. Now coming to the next part of hints, skew deviation. Now this is a supranuclear vertical misalignment of the eyes and always indicative of a posterior fossa lesion. All you have to do is do a cover uncover test that even the ophthalmologists do, and then you'll be able to see that the one eye goes up and the other goes down. This is in one of my patients. I think the arrow is working on the screen. No, the arrow doesn't work on the screen, but you can see the misalignment right here. Doesn't matter. It's okay. All right. So the last part of Hintz Plus, that is about the hearing loss. Now, if the patient has a hearing loss, then it's indicative of a labyrinthitis or an ICA infarct involving the internal auditory artery. And the MRI, it will show you a small infarct in the ICA territory. So when you have this patient presenting with an acute sudden onset vertigo, when would you ask for a neurological referral and for cerebral imaging? The patient is more than 65 years of age. He has a pre-existing vascular disorder. There's a history of vascular risk factors like smoking, hypertension, diabetes, or high cholesterol levels. And when you do a head impulse test, you get a normal head impulse or any other neurological finding that is unexplained by vestibular neuritis. Now coming to the second variety that we talked about in the very beginning. Patient presenting with recurrent positional vertigo. BPPV is the prototype of this type of presentation, and it's the most commonly diagnosed vestibular disorder. As such, the posterior canal is involved most often, representing 80% of cases of BPPV, followed by the lateral canal, which affects anywhere from, in the literature, it is written anywhere from 5 to 30%. In my practice, I think it is not 5%, but at least 20 to 25% of cases of BPPV that I see. And anterior canal, though very rare, I have just diagnosed a case day before yesterday. I mean, time didn't permit, so I could not add that case over here. Patient presents with short spells of vertigo, specifically induced by lying down and turning sides in bed. How do we differentiate it from orthostatic hypotension here? Because even in orthostatic hypotension, the patient complains of propositional vertigo, again, a very common condition. In orthostatic hypotension, the patient will complain of dizziness or vertigo on first getting out of bed. Here it is the opposite. Most often the patient complains of it only when he first lies down in bed. Okay, so here I show you a small video of posterior canal BPPV on the Dix-Hallpike test. Okay, while you're watching the video, you'll be able to see the upbeating torsional nystagmus, and in the case of a right posterior canal BPPV, it will beat in the anticlockwise direction. The torsional component will be anticlockwise, whereas on the left side, it will be clockwise. Horizontal canal BPPV also, you have the geotropic and the apogeotropic variants. Geotropic variant, the nystagmus beats towards the undermost ear. In the apogeotropic variant, it beats upwards, like not towards the earth, but towards the sky. Apogeotropic variant of horizontal canal constitutes around 25% cases of horizontal canal. Horizontal canal is diagnosed by the roll maneuver or the head roll maneuver or the so-called Maclear-Pagnini test. And of course, time doesn't permit me. The treatment for posterior canal BPPV is the Epley maneuver. Whereas for the lateral canal, the treatment is in the form of a barbecue roll or a Buffoni maneuver. For the sake of the residents present here, you can always read it in the books. Of course, there are many maneuvers, but the commonest maneuvers used are these. For the very rare anterior canal, there's a deep head hanging test that we do by placing the patient's neck around 90 degrees below the horizontal. And the maneuver with which we treat it is the Jacobino maneuver. So a few points about positional vertigo. Please never go exclusively by the patient's version. The patient who has had an attack of BPPV for the first time ever, he thinks he's already had a stroke. He'll say, "Mere ko to chakkar aa hi raha hai, band hi nahi ho raha hai." But when you do the positional test and you get the typical nystagmus pertaining to a particular canal, you have your diagnosis in your hands. Excuse me. So you should perform the test in all these patients. And another point is that a typical horizontal nystagmus or lateral canal BPPV may be elicited also on a Dick-Solpike test. So when you're doing a Dick-Solpike test for the posterior canal and you get a horizontal nystagmus, please don't start treating the patient for posterior canal BPPV. Go back to the supine head roll test, you'll find out the horizontal nystagmus is still present and treat him likewise. Another thing is the central vestibular lesions of vestibular nuclei or the caudal cerebellum can also mimic nystagmus of the lateral canal. So one has to be careful. Always assess the any downbeating nystagmus neurologically and think of imaging, because anterior canal BPPV, though it happens, but it's very rare. And also vestibular migraine, which is the second most common disorder amongst vertigo and dizziness. That's the biggest mimicker. Nystagmus pattern is of the central type, but it can present either as a horizontal or a vertical nystagmus or even a torsional nystagmus, and it can be present itself as a positional vertigo and nystagmus. So now we come to recurrent spontaneous vertigo. You have either a Meniere's disease or a vestibular migraine, and nowadays what we believe is that basically migraine and Meniere's are a complex among unto themselves, and they could be, you know, like present in the same patient, or they like almost intermingle with each other. Anyhow, for Meniere's disease, the presentation is with a rotatory vertigo lasting from a few minutes to a few hours, not usually above 5 hours, but normally from something like 15 to 20 minutes to 5 hours, whatever. Okay, and the nystagmus initially, it is in the irritative phase, so the nystagmus beats towards the affected side, and if you see the patient after some time, then it starts beating to the normal side. And then during the recovery phase, again, it will start beating to the affected side. That will be the recovery nystagmus. And presents typically with fluctuating hearing loss. Initially, the lower frequency is being involved. Later on, you get a flat audiogram. And tinnitus is always present and also presents with oral fullness. Vestibular migraine presents with rotatory vertigo or dizziness or positional vertigo, or even can be present as imbalance while walking. That's it, nothing else. Lasts for minutes to hours, but can last for a few days. By the definition, as laid down by the Barani Society for criteria for vestibular migraine, it is up to 72 hours. We have seen patients who keep complaining of vertigo for a week or so also. And the nystagmus, as I said, is of central origin. Hearing loss is very rare. Tinnitus may or may not be present. There will be a strong history of headaches. There will be a history of photophobia and phonophobia, as you usually get in a case of migraine. Now, chronic dizziness is the most difficult situation, because this patient, most likely, you are not the first doctor he has come to. He has been to many people beforehand, and he is carrying a full folder of investigations, and you don't know where to begin and how you can help this patient. But then there are a few possibilities that you have to keep in mind, and that usually help, out of which what involves us ENTs is a bilateral vestibular failure, where the patient will not have vertigo, but he'll come with a history of bobbing, oscillopsia on walking. He'll feel the things moving up and down when he's walking. If he stays still and keeps his head still, then he'll be much more comfortable and he'll be able to see clearly. And these patients have a difficulty in walking in dark or on uneven surfaces. And the other one is poorly compensated vestibular disorders, that is like a residual dizziness post a past vestibular event. Then I think I already spoke about orthostatic hypotension. Patients are usually elderly, dizziness on standing, and the BP drops on standing more than 20 millimeters of mercury. It's a systolic BP. I think I'll just skip the rest. So already talked about these. So just to sum up, well, patient presents with vertigo. You have the first ever sudden attack lasting hours to days with hearing loss. Your diagnosis is labyrinthitis. Now, if it's without hearing loss, your diagnosis is a vestibular neuritis. Recurrent events with duration of seconds happening every day for the last few days. And they are provoked by change in position. And most often these patients are elderly, those who present with BPPV. But yes, that is not a precondition. You see it in many young patients also. So that's BPPV. And you have recurrent events without loss of hearing, localized I mean, patient has unilateral headaches, presents with aura or not necessary, and there's something like a monthly frequency. Think of vestibular migraine, Meniere's disease, present with fluctuating hearing loss, tinnitus, oral fullness, and duration will be minutes to hours, recurrent attacks, of course, and persistent symptoms for a very long time, worse on walking, difficulty in dark. Think of bilateral vestibulopathy. Thank you very much for listening to me patiently.
Thank you, Dr. Avinash Vijlani, for such a vivid talk given by you. As always, you gave on vertigo. This was really very good. But can I ask a question, simple question to you, with the permission?
Yeah, sure.
So can you throw some light on the metabolic vertigo?
Sorry?
Metabolic vertigo. I want to
ask. Basically, yes, it exists, but then these patients will present only in term with a history of dizziness, not rotatory vertigo.
Hmm.
These patients will present only with a history of sense of imbalance or dizziness.
And then there will be no
really, they would really be in ENT.
It is not
a
true vertigo.
Yeah, this is not true vertigo.
Yes, that is not true vertigo. That is the point to be noted, that a lot of patients in the OPD comes with the complaints of vertigo. In fact, they are having not true vertigo, and they should be ruled out for the further investigations, right?
Right. So can I add something over here, Dr. Alok, since you have raised this issue of non-specific vertigo?
Yeah.
By far, most patients who present with non-specific vertigo, if you talk to them for 10 to 15 minutes, you'll come to realize that these are primarily suffering from what you call psychogenic vertigo or triple PD, as I just mentioned.
Not all the patients complain from psychogenic. They must have eaten something wrong in the last day, or they must have had something, disorders like in diarrhea and all. They also have some times of giddiness and vertigo.
But they don't come to us. If he has loose motions, he will first go to the physician and be treated for the loose motions, and the what you calling vertigo, whatever the dizziness is, would have been taken care of. That is basically some patients come with syncopal attacks also.
Yes, exactly. So thank you very much, Dr. Avinash, for your wonderful talk. Now, can I invite the second speaker? So second speaker is Dr. Shashi. Hello.
Just a minute, sir.
So Dr. Shashidhar will speak on the NBI. He is a very challenging surgeon, and he is a laryngologist. I have seen him in so many conferences doing the very good presentation from the NBI and all. And he is also has the interest in the pediatric surgery in the form of the laryngotracheal reconstructions, right? And subglottic stenosis and all. So I am very proud to invite him as a speaker for the this session, and he has done the robotic surgery foundation course in the 2011 from Paris, and special interest, I have told you, in the pediatrics, laryngology, and complex airway. Dr. Shashidhar, please, I invite you to talk on the NBI. Thank you.
Thank you so much for those kind words, Dr. Alok. I thank Dr. Ishwar Singh and Dr. Ravi Maher and AOI organizing body for giving me this opportunity. It's evening and I'm just holding up the quiz. Everyone is really waiting. So take a deep breath, wriggle your hands, loosen out, and I'll take you through like a management class. This is not a medical class. This is going to be a SWOT analysis, which is only done in management schools. So I thought, let's present NBI in the SWOT style. So what is SWOT analysis? It means strength, weakness, opportunity, and threat.
Sir, wise guy who was analyzing the capillaries in malignant tissue found out that a normal tissue has straight linear pattern, whereas the abnormal tissues, starting with dysplasia, show dilation in little curve, and malignant tissue is always the capillary pattern is completely disarrayed with loops and ICPAs. And the whole philosophy of NBI can be summarized in one word: intracapillary capillary loops. That is, inside the tissue, these vessels take loops. And if you see normal architecture, the vessels should go longitudinally. But since they have to feed the malignant tissue, they break this basement membrane and try to go perpendicularly. And when they go, they kind of dance like this, which is what you see in the NBI pictures, which is taken as ICPA. Now, why the NBI is called NBI? Because it's a very simple thing, like a small game in which the light source which is there, you block all the wavelengths and allow only blue and green. And when blue and green reflects to a surface, it shows the blood vessels better. And that is what the NBI picks up. It's just a small filter. It's like if you want to see a solar eclipse, you put a filter in the eye. So if you want to see a malignancy, you're putting a filter which is blocking all the light except for green and blue. And this is the simple principle of NBI. Now you can see the transition when you take histopathology. These are the loops which you can see in a normal tissue. All you see is dots, but in dysplasia, they tend to be dilated and then the loops form, and this is a classical ICPA. The biggest nuisance or the disadvantage of NBI is it cannot be performed like white light. You have to be within 3 millimeters of the mucosa. Your scope has to be very, very near the tissue. It should be free from misting, saliva, and blood, and ideally, the view should be end on, not on the sideways, but end on to the mucosa which you're visualizing. Only then you will get to see this pattern, otherwise you will just see a white light. And this is a big mistake when we see it. So classification, the knee classification, they wanted to come up with different loops. I'll skip this because it's evening. This is the SWOT analysis. So what does it do? It actually helps you to know your strengths and capitalize on the opportunity by covering the weaknesses and anticipating the threats. That's the boardroom talk. But what we have learned while we implemented NBI in our OPD practice, we have only 2 systems, and a lot of times we just end up doing NBI free of cost. That almost every lesion, whether it's benign or malignant, has some utility with NBI. This is a papilloma, which you can see. And Rinke's edema is very well visualized. The edema in one big capillary you can see with NBI. And the polyps and cysts and all the benign lesions, they don't show any vascularity pattern. That is the biggest advantage. Certain things can mimic malignancy, but they are not. These will be tuberculosis and post-radiation malignancies. These loops which you see, they are present before the radiation therapy, and sometimes they persist even after the radiation therapy. So change in these loops will be more important than actually just having a loop there. And for tuberculosis, it almost mimics a malignancy on NBI, so you have to be very careful. So it does require you to biopsy every lesion. And when you do a biopsy, there'll be some difficult interpretation. So if you're going near the gums, the tar for smokers will completely confuse you. You may think it's malignancy, but it is actually the tar from this. Post-surgery, if you want to see if you have resection margins which are inadequate, you want to go and do an NBI, it's not possible because the fibrin which is there in the wound, it covers the margins. So it's not a very good tool for post-surgery. And also for candida, when your tumor is super infected with candida, the coating and everything makes it impossible to actually do a good characterization. Reflux causes a lot of vascularity. This is the tracheal vascularity which you see in NBI. So these are the difficult interpretations. But apart from that, most of the situations will get by and you would do well. So what are we doing with the NBI? We are playing with it every single day. And what we have learned, this was a case which had autoimmune workup, biopsies done, everything done, recurrent epistaxis. And what we have learned when we saw it in NBI, that the actual capillaries network was much farther than the original site of bleeding. And then we had to do multiple cauterization, and this patient is doing all right. And then we saw that, you know, our patients, the children who were getting medical treatment for adenoids, some of them showed very good response, some of them did not show any response. And a lot of it is to do with if the adenoids are fibrosed or they have a follicular pattern. So the ones which has a lot of vascularity and follicular pattern, they respond very well to oral or topical steroids. Whereas the other ones, the older ones, the fibrosed ones, they hardly show a medical management. So it helps you to decide if you want to do surgery upfront or give medical treatment. And also it can be used as a single tool to evaluate everything in one go. So you can see the anatomical, like a posterior deviated septum, adenoid hypertrophy. You can see the sort of vascular pattern, the cobblestone appearance of the pharynx, and also the lingual hypertrophy. And after 3 months of medical treatment, you can actually go back and see the cobblestone has disappeared, the adenoids have shrunk, and the nose is free from sinusitis. So this is a study which is ongoing in pediatric age group in our institute, where we are using NBI extensively in treatment of chronic sinusitis in children. A lot of people will think it's a very expensive tool. This is what we had to show to the management. For those in the private sector, the orange line is the cost you would get putting a charge of maybe 2,000 per endoscopy. And this is the return in 6 months when you say you have done 3 endoscopies a day. And the blue line is with the NBI when you put an approximate cost of 4,000 per endoscopy. So it does recover the, you know, cost if you're doing about 3 to 5 endoscopies a day within a year. That's just for the, you know, cost analysis when you say it's a very expensive tool. What else it can do? It's one of the good tools for benign lesions, and it's as good as stroboscopy. And there are extensive number of studies which kind of show that all the sulcus vocalis and polyps and nodules are well visualized and they're well demarcated by NBI. And when you look at the malignant lesions, intraoperatively, it can upstage your tumor margins in about 36% cases, and it can find new lesions in about 17% cases. So group one is actually in OPD examination, group two is under general examination. So it does really change the way you are going to do the surgery once you look at it in the NBI. So if this margin is what you see in the normal light, when you put it in the NBI, the resection margin looking at the vascularity pattern is much, much bigger. So this was the most interesting study. About 560 patients were there in this study, where they found that compared to white light, the NBI performed 98% recurrence free for a T1, T2 lesions in patients. So that's a really good improvement in the results. But the real difficulty is interpretation of these loops, forms, and lesions. So one of the things they wanted to look is what is the agreeability. So the agreeability index is taken as Kappa index. So to give you an example, if typical 50 to 60 year old spouse, male and husband and wife will have a Kappa index of about 0.6. 1 means they completely agree and they're a mirror of each other. 0 means they really agree. So it is exactly the same Kappa index, the inter-rater observation, what you see in white line, and little better when you use it as a tool between different people. So it can be fairly standardized. Now, this is one of the most interesting uses in oncology is for the assessment of unknown primaries. So straight away going to the pan endoscopy, you can actually do a flexible NBI. And this is the case which I'm trying to show here is this patient had a PET scan negative, twice biopsied from the margins. How do I get to play this? Okay. And when we did an NBI, sorry for the break. So you can see at the center, these lesions are there, the capillary loops are there. So instead of doing the conventional marginal biopsy, we have to take actually the biopsy from the center, and then it turned out to be positive. So this study, which kind of showed that, you know, almost 35% detection rate was increased when you incorporated NBI in your assessment chart. Same for nasal examinations, you can use NBI to see the polyps, nasal polyps. And differentiate it from inverted papilloma. Like in this scenario, this is the middle turbinate, but as soon as you come into the papilloma part, you can see these loops coming out. These are the ICPLs which are there in papilloma. The other use, which is now very interesting, is in reflux, and they have come up with dots, brown dots, either which are very sparse or tufted, they are the signs of reflux. And this study, when they gave medical treatment to the patients, these dots disappeared. And now for the last 2 years, several articles have been popping up trying to show that NBI is extremely useful, as good as double pore pH to see the reflux. In my own practice, I would use it for children because that's one thing we kind of miss out on children, that they do have severe reflux and it is undertreated in a lot of cases. The other things which is associated on NBI are green spots, contact ulcers, and granulomas. But this is not the only technology which does it. There are some parallel technologies which are going, like autofluorescence, fluorescence imaging, where you inject a fluorescence dye and the protoporphyrin 9 is actually seen with the infrared camera and the tumor glows like this. And there is an optical coherence tomography which can go inside the depth. The biggest disadvantage of NBI is it cannot go inside the depth of the tissue, which is only met by another OCT and Raman spectroscopy, both of which are completely investigational in the field of cancer, but it's being used for other lesions. Now I have to tell you the other part, which is sort of a blanket hush hush talk, is the NBI only technology which does the work? And what is SPICE and iScan? Are they the same or they're not? The NBI is actually the thing which you get from the company is the technology which they say, but you get a light source which is only in red, which is not having red light, but only green and blue. But even after other companies which have come with stores, the SPICE system actually uses a normal white light, but what it does is here, instead of capturing image in the different light, what it does is it uses a software to cut down all the other colors and increase turquoise orange. So this image which is in the middle is a store SPICE system, which is very similar to the NBI. And most of the literature or the results say they have exactly the same performance, whether you use it, the stores or the SPICE or the iScan. So in the end, when you look at the SWOT, it has excellent optics. You might just get the system only for the optics, the HD quality of the image. This is good for benign lesions, malignant lesions. It's good for occult malignancy, HD quality. And it's a very good documentation system. It can upstage or downstage the cancer and alter your management. The weaknesses are it's expensive, it has a learning curve, subjectivity in assessment, the other things which can obscure visualization. The opportunities are for cancer screening. This is one thing we have not done very well because we did NBI camps and that didn't really fare well, maybe because of the COVID issue, but we are still working on this and probably we'll get more and more NBI camps on cancer screening. And the threads are, you have parallel technologies running in. Even if you don't have an NBI, you can take a normal image, work it up on a computer, and you can actually make it in an NBI image. So all this equipment is not absolutely essential, but it's definitely very convenient to have it while you're doing live surgery that you can see the vascularity. And its negative predictive value is still high to have litigation issues. That is, you say the patient, he doesn't have a cancer, and 3 months or 6 months down the line, he gets a cancer. So you cannot proclaim that NBI is foolproof. What else it is doing, it's integrated into a 4K system, which is only making it much better. And now the gastro and other scopes, it is called ME magnification endoscopy with NBI. So this system can be mounted on a Da Vinci robot or any of the other endoscopic systems to really increase the contact features of the NBI. You can even mark a tumor on the iPad with a stylus and program the robot to do a transoral laser microsurgery. And lastly, we are using big data and artificial intelligence so that tumor marker can be very accurately predicted beforehand the resection. This is Dr. Rakesh, if you're interested in reading about NBI. This is the only book which is available solely dedicated to NBI. And very proud to say that it's written by Dr. Rakesh, a dear friend and colleague, and he likes to put this photograph for several reasons. Thank you so much. My only quote is, if you know how to play with colors, you can save a lot of lives. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Shashidhar, for your vivid talk regarding the NBI. NBI is a wonderful tool if it is used rightly. And we do have in our department, not the NBI, but the eye scan system, which we commonly use in our department. We have the system of Pentax. And we do feel that it does make a difference when you change to the eye scan or you change to the NBI, then some obscure region which you might miss on the normal endoscopy, you can pick up those lesions. So this is a wonderful technology which is being developed, and technology is developed like these ways. So and nobody knows in future what is in future of NBI, but it is definitely a very good technology. Thank you, Dr. Shashidhar, for a wonderful talk on NBI. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shashidhar and Dr. Andash Chitani for excellent talks. I would like now to invite Dr. Ishwar Singh to facilitate Dr. Avinash Jidlani and Dr. Shashidhar. So we come to the end of the invited talk, and now we'll start the quiz, and I invite Dr. Manish Munjal our quiz master to take the stage.
I think the first
can I have the team from AIIMS, Dr. Anupama
and Dr. Anupam and Dr. Abhimanyu.
Anupam and Abhimanyu.
Abhimanyu. So team A, Dr. Anupam and Dr. Abhimanyu from AIIMS. Team B, Prathar, you want paper? So, team A, Dr. Anupam and Dr. Abhimanyu from AIIMS. Team B, Dr. Nitin Singh and Dr. Vashi Gupta from UCMS. Team C, Dr. Gautam and Dr. Lita Justin from Safdarjung Hospital. Team D, Sonali Malhotra and Dr. Deeksha Sharma from Lady Harding. And Team E, Dr. Karandi and Dr. Dasila. So I would just like to introduce Dr. Manish Munja. He's a very dear friend and we were colleagues sometimes back, from 20 years back at Kolkata. And he is very much interested in dysphagia and laryngology. He's a member of Laryngology and Voice Association. He's a member of All India Rhinology Society and Associate Otolaryngologist. And his main area of interest is laryngology. So I welcome Dr. Manish Munja for the quiz.
So team C is the lead writing working
and
Vashi Gupta.
Vashi, Vashi. Vashi. Yeah. He is a governor. He has a lot of
awesome. Vera, you are a lot of
Sonali and Yurika. Thank you.
All right, how do I bring out my presentation? Presentation. Okay, so there is a mention of, I initially thought that we had less participation. Thank you for waiting till this time. Knowledge can never be absolute, neither I hold it, neither Dr. Ishwar Singh, neither your best of your teachers, neither you. So it's an eternal learning process. And we also plug these questions out from various places. And we are very, medicine, unlike other fields, it is subjective in some areas. So please don't feel bad. If one book, I have taken an answer, it brings out some relevance according to me to a question, and you think it was otherwise. So we'll have no discussions or too much, because ultimately it evens out. And the matter is all for fun.
The decision of the quiz master is final.
Pen drive. Kaise meri list hai na pen drive. Manish 2022. Manish. Just a minute. Delhi away. Isme state quiz do hai. Final.
This one.
Yeah. A little bit worried about videos not playing the 4-5 videos. So we'll try to see if something like that happens. I've got this list of questions in my hand. Okay. So I've been tied to Dr. Anup Raj today by Dr. Ravi. Everywhere I have to follow sir. And initially in the morning, I was giving, so he will be happy. He was never happy with me in the time when I was there as a postgraduate and senior resident. We used to have a lot of fights. Can you believe somebody could fight with Dr. Lubran? I used to. But still, it was a good time till 2006. You are all new now, but...
I've seen Dr.
Right.
And in fact, there were two...
No, not that kind of.
What argument, and that's it.
No, but ultimately we could do that because he was a human and he dealt us in a way where we could take, you know, those personal liberties. But in the end, at the end of the day, I would always say that your teachers are your teacher. We had an innate respect for them. That is why they could tolerate a little bit of our imbecile attitude at times, but wonderful. So there is a little bit change in my program here. Initially, it was supposed to be for 4 teams of 2 players each. The rounds remain, however, the same. I'll have to manufacture a few questions. I had kept them from the audience round, but since the audience here is, do you still have those, that bag, Ravi? Okay, you can keep it. But we'll have 5 teams because we thought it'll be a good way to represent all these first 5 teams have been really close, 1 or 2 marks out of 24. So we could keep 5 teams. I'm happy with that. Now, somebody has to do the scoring. You're doing it. When we ask a question from, say, team A, and they answer it, they will get 10 marks. And there are no negative marks. Okay, because there are negative marks. This is the -5 for a negative. But if you pass it and it goes to the other team, they can earn 5 marks for that. Okay,
bonus point.
That is a bonus point. But you do not, if you also make a mistake, you will also get minus 5. Then that's a different, even a panga that if you take, it's only for 5 marks, but you lose, you can lose 5 also on that. And when we do the, later on, the last round will be a rapid fire round, where I have this list, I'll randomly start asking, and we'll be at a certain speed. In 1 minute time, we'll ask the question. And I hope to ask 6 to 7 questions from each team. And the questions will be without multi-choice for answers. But if you are unable to answer, you can take your time, but that wastage will lead to a loss of your marks, but not negative marks, okay? So last underlying disclaimer is please don't argue or this thing, otherwise you will be disqualified immediately, okay? So are we ready? We'll start from...
Negative 5,
yes, yes, yes.
No negative in rapid fire.
No negative in rapid fire, but if you keep on answering wrongly, you will have to pay with minus 5, okay? But you can pass it, that you can do. Yeah. And of course, if nobody is able to answer, then that they are eligible for the whoever is sitting here. We can't give virtual chocolates. We have to find out that technology. We'll ask Columbus later on how to give virtual chocolates. But right now for this hall, we have the normal chocolates, please. So here we go. We'll start from team A, right? Okay. So this, here comes your question. This is a kind of mixed up, but this is about history. So this is a famous surgeon, and you have to identify him. Well, the questions may be a combined two questions in one, but I will decide what is the weightage. If you are not able to answer a part of an important question, then you get 0 marks or a minus. And if you are able to answer well, then you will get a even a partly will might fetch you a good answer. Can you tell me who is this famous surgeon and what is his contribution to ENT?
Professor Mather Greenwood, his contribution is anterior to posterior face. Approach to face, anterior to posterior face.
So wonderful, we start off with a good start. And I mean, in my time, we never used to watch these things, but I think with the internet, you have started seeing some. It's important to know our history, right? So this is a good start. And you're from AIIMS, right? So did well in the prelims also. Okay. Come to the next question for team B. Now this is a scientist, again not can call him an ENT surgeon, but is associated with our field. Of course, he is looking from another century, as you can see in the photo. This is the only scientist who has won a Nobel Prize for an ENT related field. What is he and what for? Are you answering? Say again and loud. I couldn't hear it all. No? You want to pass it? Okay, team C. Can you make out? No. Team D? Pass. Team E? An important Nobel Prize winning scientist. Huh? Sorry, make a seat. You'll have to take negative marks for that. I'm sorry. But the good thing is, right now, we have to write minus 5. No, it's not vacancy. Can anybody from the audience answer? One minute. No, no, not the participants, please. Oh, yeah, they have not seen. Yeah, sorry, it goes around that.
Professor Barani.
Yeah, that's right. For the vestibular apparatus, I was even more. Well, that's a really good answer. But one vacancy was not too far away. I think you wanted to tell me it was audiology. I wish I could grant you something, but sorry about that. You tried well. Okay, sometimes you have to take risks in life. Okay. Okay, can we go on to the next question? Who is coming now? Next, it goes to team C, right? Okay. So again, a famous music teacher, looking very elegant, Team C, and music teachers have got great roles. They talk about music, they sing about music, they must be good singers also. So who is this guy and what did he do? You're going to open up history books today about E&D. I like reading about such things. So you will find these type of questions in my answers. C cannot answer. D?
He was a Spanish guy, music teacher. He did otolaryngoscopy. And his name is Emmanuel Gracia.
Okay, right. Gracia is thank you, but it is Garcia, but I think give it. But what did he do? I still don't get a good answer from you.
Indirect.
Yes, thank God. Thank God. That's the right answer. So he developed indirect laryngoscopy. He developed the indirect laryngoscopy mirror even at the time when there was no headlight or anything. So he used to use sunlight. Reflection of sunlight to do that, and later on the head mirrors and all started coming, concave mirrors. So good, somebody came in, and now I think you have the main question as well. So they earned the bonus points, right? 5 points. Now they are also coming to the main question. Now probably the smartest ENT surgeon that I have seen looks like a Hollywood star, and you should not, this is supposed to be a relatively easy answer if you have read some good textbooks of ENT. Who is he? Post-World War, pre our birth era, but somewhere who has done great job. And as you can see, Hollywood looks so, maybe you know the country also, right? No prompting, please. Your time is moving. You want to take the chance? I don't think so. We can't spend that much time. Yes, TE. Okay. But you'll have to come with the answer. What did he do? It's a very important part of this this thing. I can, if you don't answer, I will not give you negative marks, but I will not give you positive either. Okay. What is he famous for? Okay, wonderful. Yeah, that I can give. So he worked basically on stepidectomy, directly in your technique of stepidectomy, and therefore he's very well known. Wonderful, wonderful. Father of otosclerosis surgery, modern otosclerosis surgery. Yeah. So we have one more last question of this round for the teams. Okay, so that's what John shared. You know, I always write answers because I have a huge chance that I might forget them myself. Right. Okay. So it's not about all foreigners. We have, as you can see, it doesn't look like a foreigner at all. And at least people from who are from this part of the world should actually revere with him, and you should know who he is. He's no more now, but can you tell me, tell us, he's been into our conferences many times. Okay, Dr. Nirvan, I said he's no more. Okay, we come to AIIMS, but they get negative, huh? They get negative marks.
Pass.
Ravi, see? No. They have to go through. Please, pass. Pass. Wow, okay, one minute. No seniors first. I will give the chance to juniors first because I know the senior. I have been his driver every time when he came over. Anyone who is young and can raise the hand.
I mean,
with part of the question are you raising? Huh? But so two people, I think gender is Shashidhar. So I'll ask him. Who is he? You raise your hand. Are you the youngest who has been? So you don't want to attempt? Huh?
I don't want to.
Okay.
M.C.
Manish Munjal. Dr. Mahadevaiya, Vipin will get, sir. So have you heard of Dr. Vijender from Bangalore? You must have seen his temple. So he's the first and the foremost, most favorite student of Mahadevia, and even Dr. Bachendra's clinic, it is he is going to Mahadevia center also, and he is doing surgeries in his center also. But he's the first student who made big, very prime student of Dr. Mahadevia.
Dr. Mahadevia is from AIMS Delhi.
Oh, I didn't know that. Thank you, sir.
Mahadevia visited our temple.
Yes.
During one of
pioneer surgeon from South India for basically mastoid surgeries. Right, wonderful.
I just want to add the last question. It's not to Popper and Theodor Popper. He was given Nobel Prize for parrot surgery.
Yeah, but you know, at that time, your addendum is well accepted. But the thyroid being also in the general surgery profile, so I didn't want to say that's a pure ENT surgery, but definitely audiology we would like to claim.
The only surgeon who has ever got a Nobel.
Yes.
And the only surgeon. 1990s.
Yeah. Wonderful. So there's one audience question still I had in the series, and again, it might elicit a little bit of sigh from the older guys. But let's see, some youngster can tell me who's he. So this is the one I'm talking about. No. Anybody from the youngsters who can tell us?
He was my MBBS examiner.
Okay, he was.
We had an oration in the morning.
Wonderful. We had an oration in the morning. Wonderful. Then I think the youngsters should have answered it. Yes. He had an oration in his name. The first oration was in his name. So, the lady there, ma'am, you want to attend? No, you don't want to attend. Why? Any junior? Shashi wants to actually say that he's not looking old as yet. And that is why he's ducking the question. That won't be enough. There are two Kakkars who are there. Dr. Prem Kakkar. The other one is Dr. Santosh Kakkar. Dr. P.K. Kakkar is no more. He lost him around 2 years ago. And wonderful pioneer, pioneering guy, towering guy. He was close to 6.5 feet. I mean, if Dr. Ishwar Singh also stood with him, you would say, oh, like Ishwar Singh is not very tall. So you can very well imagine what was his height.
His nickname among the residents was Lumbi.
Wonderful. So,
chocolate for you. Let's catch it. Thank you.
So we finished the first round, which was most about the historical perspectives. Can we have a scoring for the as how the teams stand?
Team A 15 points, Team B 0 points, Team D plus 5, and Team E minus 5.
Okay, Team E has taken the maximum risk. I still have respect for that team very well. They've answered a lot, tried to answer, and that's how you may win, you may lose, but you must still take the chances. So the next round will start therefore from their side. Okay. Well, I would tell them how I passed my MBBS. I was made to pass below his legs. May I think his legs either whoever will pass without touching the back will pass. In MBBS, it was like that. So that's okay. Well, we were all failing, I think, and the whole class had been failed. And then finally he came and said, nobody will pass, fail in MIT. And he made sure that everybody did. Wonderful. So we come to E. We're starting from E now. Are you ready? So this is now a little bit of technique and technology, but if I do not get the video, I am really skeptical about video not running a scene through the day. If we don't, then I'll give a hint, or I'll skip the question, but do not jump on the answer. Okay. So this is a 60-year-old female with dysphagia, with a neck swelling on the left side, and she underwent this particular transoral surgery. It's a very short clip, see? And this is what you see from the transoral route. That's what they did. Thank God the video worked. So this is after the surgery. It's a very short thing, but it's a vital step that we saw in the surgery.
Do you want me to play the video again? Okay. So it's like a laryngoscope. I'll give you a hint. We'll see through the laryngoscope. It's actually a Vierda laryngoscope. This is one of my clips. It's a Vierda laryngoscope, which opens, the blades open like these. And then we just went in and did this small little step. See inside, you go, this is the instrument coming out, and then you see what you saw. I deliberately tried to make it a little bit tough, otherwise it had been. So you have seen it, you want to say what it is?
It's a surgery for Zenker's diverticulum.
Okay, wonderful, yeah, that's right. It's a surgery for Zenker's diverticulum, and it is an endoscopic stapedial, stapes assisted, staple assisted diverticular colectomy, right? And I use mainly the laser for this surgery, to use the carbon dioxide laser, but congratulations, you got the full marks. Kuch asaan question bhi hona chahiye, nahi? And there are, of course, can anybody say, tell me in the audience, which is the main reason for a Zenker's diverticulum? Anybody, what are the, what is it, what type of diverticulum? It's a pulsion, traction, and what is the reason behind it? Which muscle fibers are responsible? The upper part of thyroid and the upper part of crico and the lower part of thyroid, the oblique muscle, and from there the it's a pulsion diverticulum. Good.
Here you can have it again. Thank you.
Okay, so we go on to the next question for team B now, right? Because you answered right. Team B, this 40-year-old woke up with sudden severe left side facial pain, and you can see some findings. I don't want to make it easy. What is the likely diagnosis and the treatment? What are the chances of recovery? You have to answer the question in a totality, because this is not that difficult. We'll have to give points for a good answer, not the and the specifics. So read it again. You have to answer in 2-3 parts. What is the likely diagnosis, treatment? They're all one-worded answers. And what is the chance of recovery possibly? Okay, will we take that? I think yes. But the organism? HSV? Thank God. Okay, that's a good prompt. And what is the treatment for this? Mainly, I don't want to ask you the sidey things. What is the main treatment? Just 1 day old comes to you suddenly, mooted ho gaya, pain shuru ho gaya. What will you give? Okay, steroids. How many would support steroids initially? Would you? Okay, I'll give it to them. But basically, antivirals should have come. What is the dose of antivirals for a zoster infection? Oh, thank God. And what is the chance of recovery in a herpes zoster? Is it, I mean, if you compare to Bell's palsy, poor prognosis. Well, how many would agree with that? Poor prognosis? Not really. Ek bari achha answer de do, iska last part. Chalo, I'll give it to that. I mean, we have a good 95% chance recovery in herpes zoster. So you must remember that. Because I had also not written it, but therefore, it's not the same total recovery like Bell's, but in a few percent, 5 to 10%, we say that some residual is there. But they got the full marks, maybe on prompting, next time we'll not do. Okay, coming to team C now, okay. Team C, this is a question for you. I would say that's a relatively easy, but a back question. We have this instrument here. Okay, can you see this instrument? Now it's got a gun type of a look. It's got a flat blade
and it's got a lock on the back side. This instrument is not used in our part of the world that much these days. Which is this instrument and what is one specific seat layer or complication of this? Can you tell me? I'm a statist. No. Hey, you are the organizer, man.
I have this instrument in my museum.
Oh, you have it in the museum. Thank God.
Not if you think.
Okay. Have your resident seen the instrument?
Yes, I think they have.
So I think you'll pass on. B. Ames, no chance. Coming back to team E. Quiet. You are the ones who are taking the chances. You have to be loud.
This is for conspiracy for guillotine.
Wonderful. I think we'll give them the mark. They deserve. But tell me, I mean, it is a very good question. It's a very specific complication for which it is not followed in rest of the world. Tonsillectomy is a commonest surgery in many ways for the pediatric age group, but guillotine tonsillectomy has lost favor. And that is the reason why. You have to tell me. No, it is very good. It's the best hemostatic surgery actually in tonsillectomy, gold surgery. Besides coblation now, but I'll give you the marks, no problem. But you have to still tell me why it is unpopular. Anybody here? Yes, sir.
It won't work in contracted tonsils.
Okay, yeah, that's one reason, but it's not a complication, sir. I'm looking for the complication.
You can't remove it.
No.
There is
no.
A cyst formation because it doesn't remove the magna part is seen and that needs
No. It is a specific surgery in which there's anterior pillar scarring because the part of the mucosa of anterior pillar gets affected in the surgery the maximum. So anterior pillar damage is the most in guillotine tonsillectomy. And if the reasons are the ones that you have said, there could be a contracted for it. You need a hanging tonsil which can be bought inside. Yes. Pedunculated ones are the best. Well, that could be the sickle, but what is listed in British journal is that it causes scarring. But bleeding is the best controlled by guillotine. The hemostasis rates are as good as this thing. So, anyway, we gave the bonus to team E. Good. So, next question goes to team B. Okay. Okay, now this I had also asked in the last conference and in the last quiz that I had done, this nobody had been able to answer, so just took a chance that I keep the slide again. No, only you. Team B, this is, I have modified, made it easy. This is actually an anesthesia instrument. Which procedure uses it? Because nobody could make out at that time. Any idea? Just try to see, I mean, each and every part that you see of the instrument, at least including the cord and all, is very important. Where it is going, which structure it is attaching to. Just try to think. What is that, you know, how do I point out? Can I take a pointer? Then hill na jaye sab kuch. This you can see where the arrow is. Check the arrow in the US. So this arrow is a very modern machine where it's going. So what is it? I think you can't answer, right?
Pass.
Arre yaar. Prelims se itne achhe number liye tumne kya gaya? Haan. Okay, large part of the answer is right, but unfortunately, it's not a high frequency jet ventilation. It is a special name. It is a, you see the pump in the hand, the pump has a meter. A high frequency will never have a meter. It doesn't require, it's a big machine. The monsoon tube system that we use for HFR is a high frequency. It doesn't require pressure monitoring. What would require a pressure monitoring? Which type of?
Manual,
yes. But it has a name. There's an Italian name behind it. There's an Italian guy who devised it. So they have given a name. But I think, does the audience believe that they should get the bonus points first? They get the, so it's a Venturi jet meter, right? And one of the most it's the oldest actually jet ventilator available. It's the simplest. We use a lot in Gangaram. Anybody can tell me in the audience what is the main complication one is afraid of while using jet ventilator? Yeah, you बहुत जवाब दे चुका कोई और भी दे दे. That lady there, yeah, young girl. Sorry. Well, in all ventilation, jet airway ventilation, we have that problem. But specific to this, yes, it can cause tension pneumothorax because the pressures have to be controlled with hands. Relatively high pressure. Wonderful. Take the good. So wonderful. And who's next now? Okay. Team A. Bonus given. I think everybody agrees. Bonus given. So, what is this procedure? I hope it works. Yeah. And which instrument, you have to tell me specifically which instrument is being used. In the, of course, it's an ENT procedure. What is this procedure and which ENT instrument? This is from our own hospital. Yeah.
Laser-assisted silolithotripsy.
Good. But I need the other thing. Which laser is being used?
Holmium.
Good, that's full marks to them. I said laser, but I thought you were coming to that. So is it a contact laser, by the way, or what kind of laser is holmium laser? Tell me, now that I'm testing your knowledge.
Not sure.
Okay. It has got its own focal length, visual focal length, the bright neon light. When it is focused on it, it's not a contact laser. And it works by dispersion of the vibratory beam, and it's a shock by which you break it. It's the same laser which is used in urology surgeries, but we are using slightly lower nanometer wavelength, like 30 is being used, and above in urology we use it between 15 to 30, right? But we share the laser, so you got the bonus points, right?
No, bonus
primary point. Sorry, I mean, they are doing the monitoring. Good job, I always bungle on that. So who's, have we finished this round? No.
Yes,
we are finished. So where are we standing?
Team A is having the highest marks with 25 points in total of both the rounds.
Good.
And team B and C are at plus 15 points.
D and E.
So E has really come off well. They are the underdogs. They are posing up a challenge. And I think the duo of Sadaji and the Anglo lady, they are doing so well. But the big combination already, yeah, she's speaking in a slang language. Sadaji is like in his own style. And they are the underdogs right now, but they are doing well. Ames on one side and middle all doing well. So we come to the next. Where do we start now from? This side, huh? Team A, we start from you now. Okay, that was your answer. Okay, this is supposed to be an easier round for me, but a little bit of radiology, but out by this time, people need marks, so we'll go from you. You're the lucky people, let's see. 25-year-old male reports sudden loss of hearing. The TM is intact. As you can see a hair shadow just behind the TM, if you can make out from the scutum. Scutum is also intact. There's a profound loss though of hearing. What is the likely pathology and treatment? And the treatment has been proposed by a certain classification. So what do you think this is? And do watch the interior side of the disease process. I have a very classy slide showing a lot of destruction of tissue inside. 25-year-old male, sudden hearing loss. What should it be? Intact TM.
Glomus jugular.
Okay. Sudden loss, glomus jugular. But you have answered. I can't give it to you now. It has to, they get the negative. So who gets the next?
Team B.
B. See the destruction. And of course, it's not glomus jugular. So it has to be something. The pathology is not in the middle ear, it's mostly behind that. Where do you see the pathology? Okay. Well, I thought they would be able to answer this. Team C. Come on, 25-year-old man. No pain, TM intact. I have not told another important thing, but that would have clinched all the diagnoses. But I didn't want to say that. It'll make it too easy. But what's the likely pathology? There's no discharge, nothing, no bleeding. As I said, this it can't be glomerular jugular, but TM is intact. What could it be? Huh? No pain, no palsies so far. No? Team B? Not sure. Wonderful, yeah. Well, it's a petus apex cholesteatoma. It can be congenital, but you still not answered the second part. Who proposed the classification? That's another one with the classical classification. Can you tell? I'll still give the again. They're counting on the marks because of the bonus. They're Lackey and Clemens. That's right. That's the one we follow from the OCN. But I know Levinson classification is also there for the same. Okay, great. So they are doing a lot better on bonus marks than true ones. Good, good. Whenever that is something different about this team. Okay, good. So can we come to the next question then? It will be coming to you, right? Team C, not Team B. Team B. Second question, right?
Team B.
Team B. Okay, which is the following test that you see on this and what is the most likely diagnosis? What the easy question, I think. Yeah. Okay. Well, they answered it wrong. Yeah. If it was radioactive iodine, why would you have two things here also, right? Show me. Next one. Team C. There's a single thing shining down there, and there are two more things above. What can it be, ma'am? Team C. Yeah. Anything? Well, there's hypertense makeup and there's light makeup on the other sides. Huh? What can it be? Yeah. Yeah. We are taking the chance. That's right. That's the right answer. It's a systemic V scan, and it is done for what? Huh? Parathyroid adenoma. So it's to diagnose a primary parathyroid adenoma, and this you can see that is coming quite well. But is it good enough for surgery? When you take anybody in the audience, is it the you still follow? And directly go in for surgery, or these days you do another investigation. Right. So they get the bonus marks.
PET.
No, not PET.
PET.
Sorry.
PET.
कुछ और ही है. तो मैंने पढ़ाई नहीं. Well, it's a radiologist from your Medanta earlier who does very well. Huh?
SPECT.
SPECT, but it is a kind of. Yeah, CT SPECT is nowadays. I was reading about it. Yes. But at least in our part of the world and good centers, ultrasonography, high definition 4D ultrasound, actually SPECT is also four dimensional CT scan.
Yeah.
So that is the thing. I have you answered it better than me. So. Yeah. You can. Did we have a thing about parathyroids in this conference? No. So I think you can tell us whether what is the ideal surgery for this condition, Dr. Bipin?
Basically, it looks like
a
primary hyperparathyroidism. And this is not an anatomical localization. This is not a part of surgery. So what you need is to explore and then need to move the tumor and then again intraoperative paracontrol
level. Intraoperative or immediate post-op is very important. And I think, what do you employ, a four-gland exploration these days or what? Or if it's that clear, I think you would believe it, isn't it? Done. Fantastic. So we go on to the next question. Who takes the next question?
BMC.
BMC. Should be easy now.
Okay, a 35-year-old, this is all radiology, I think, going on. 35-year-old patient presents with symptoms of unilateral tinnitus and mild hearing loss. MRI scan shows a 3-centimeter size CP angle tumor here. It's a benign tumor, as you can see. What is your advice? There are advice, I mean, you have to tell the diagnosis and the treatment. 3 centimeters. I would not give you any marks if you answer partly for this question. Yes, it's a vestibular schwannoma, unilateral. And very important part, the description tells us what, how should the patient be treated. Surgical management. Now, how would anybody be associated with that? I don't think I can pass this question for marks, but I can pass this to our audience, but I'll not give you the answer. Yes. Yes, yes, that's right. See, it's a young female, and why does one important thing, if you see the scan, there's a part intracanalicular and a part majorly extracanalicular tumor. So surgery management, open surgery will still leave the residue in the intracanalicular part according to most neurosurgeons. And you cannot do a vestibular ablation where you open the Bell's bar and then you go and take out the entire tumor from there. So there's a little bit of a confusion what should be the management. But the best way would be a gamma knife. It will definitely halt the progression if possible. And she's a 35-year-old, hearing conservation should be the theme. So gamma knife was the right answer. I wish you had answered it. So no marks. No marks, I think. No marks. Okay, everybody agrees with that? No marks, right? So next question goes to?
Team B.
B.
Manish, in the last question, the size of 3 centimeters. What is the best treatment?
Sir, up to 2 centimeters, even if it is asymptomatic. Or symptomatic, there's a wait and watch policy for 2 centimeters. You do serial 1-year scans. 1 year, every year one must go scan or see the symptoms. But if there is a symptom.
He's a young female.
Yes.
And probably he has much more life left. So ideally, it should be removed.
Yes.
Why,
removed as in?
As a middle child hooked up.
No.
Because you want to preserve the hearing.
You want to preserve the hearing, but you can first do the gamma knife. Gold standard would be gamma knife, where you know even in removal, you will not be able to drill the intracanalicular part that convincingly. So better to first try to shrink it. This I, because I was confused, so I called up a neurosurgeon to ask this question.
You
should
not have included the age there in your question.
Okay, and why is that, sir?
Because you're confusing the candidate.
Okay. But if it was an elderly, then.
Elderly, 70 years old, then definitely not a gamma knife.
No, but youngster, you would like to go for definitive surgery also. But I mean, intracanalicular, they say that you should not do surgery immediately if the hearing is poor. That also.
Consider your answer as final.
All right, then fine. Okay, meanwhile, you have seen the next question for long. So what do you think deformity is? It's a very famous name. And what is the best way to avoid this deformity? I mean, by what kind of reconstruction can you avoid? Yeah.
Deformity seen as anti-gum deformity.
Okay, perfect.
And we can avoid this by at least keeping 1 centimeter of the... By reconstruction,
I'll ask you to change your answer. In cancer, you cannot compromise on the resection. You have to reconstruct with something to make sure that there's the. I wanted a reconstruction answer. What is the best? Yes, free fibula flap. Okay, so we'll give the answer. So, free fibula flap reconstruction, because in this soft tissue flaps, advancement flaps will not work. You have to do a reconstruction. We used to do titanium graft, and I think Dr. Isha Singh and I, we have been part of his team, we've done so many, but nowadays avascular graft,
these titanium, all of them have gone into this favor. You have to do a tree fibula flap. That's it. Why is tree fibula a good flap for the jaw and not a radial tree for forearm? Okay, they have double barreling and but multiple fracture, why is it more possible in free fibula and not in radial? Yes, and subperiosteum blood supply, that is there. So anyway, good. Oh, wow. I have a diplomatic immunity, okay? I'm like the president of the United US of A. I like Donald Trump. I do whatever, pick up whatever. You can't question me.
I take back my question.
He was asking the general knowledge of audience, not yours.
Okay, so we are now on the last team, and they have been doing well with the bonuses. Now, let's see. Okay, this is my own a video that I made. I hope it plays. This is a stroboscopic video of a non-malignant disorder. Again, a very short clip. Please see it very carefully. Right? I can run it again. There's no sound, sorry. It's not coming. Oh, are you? Kahan se are you? So I'll still tell you, he's saying, I'm making him say E, but it is not a bad voice. There is no problem with the voice, but I'm still really relying on the stroboscopy for my examination. I can see the answer when he opens up his larynx. Just light glimpse I see. You can see it again. See? Just a bit. Have you made up your mind to answer? Yeah, tell me. Spasmodic dysphonia. Where did you see the spasms, by the way? Do you see any spasms? I'm just trying to see it myself. He's quite clear on that. I think you get the negative marks. You're still doing good on bonuses. When they open up the vocal cords, just try to see just a small glimpse somewhere. See it again. See this opening up? You see something here on the top? And then it trickles down and on the side, you see something. I go, how can I say everything? Do you see that? Anyway, right? Can you answer?
Intubation granuloma.
Okay, so you saw the granuloma, right? There's no history of intubation. Why would you say intubation granuloma? I'll give you another chance. I'll say there was no intubation. But yes, there's a left-sided granuloma kind of thing. What is exactly? I say it's a disorder of hyperfunction. Please see it. The answer should not have given you marks, but I'm still giving you. Sorry, my voice is my field. So it's a disorder of hyperfunction. Now, if you don't say it, then I can't give you marks at all.
Contact granuloma?
Yes, that's a contact secondary granuloma to the extent that a person is having a little bit of bleeding, and that is because it bleeds, he's hitting the posterior part of the vocal processor hitting against each other, and these people have got pain, you know, when they speak. They will come to you with painful speech. There is absolute clear voice. This is the person who is a businessman in West Delhi. He had a automobile shop, rich guy, but he was had to shout in the traffic, and he started having pain while speaking. And what is the treatment for it?
So speech therapy and painkillers.
Okay, initial I'll give it to you. I would give it as speech therapy, but I've started doing Botox for these patients, and they do tremendously well, because the idea is to, you know, create a disharmony between the two vocal cords and slow one of them. And with that, sometimes you do get very desirable results. But the first choice is still speech therapy. Because he responds with speech therapy, which he did, frankly, in this case, he did. So, wonderful. So, they get the bonus, yeah, plus 5. So, where are we now? Back to, we are now on the last round, right?
Right now, markings.
Markings, yes.
Team A is 25 marks.
Okay.
Team B minus 5.
They got some more marks, no? Bonus also.
Nine.
Minus 5 and plus 5.
Okay, okay, right.
Team B minus 5. Team C 0. Team D.
Itna tough to nahi hai, because.
Team D 30. Team E 50.
So who's got 30?
Team D.
Wow, okay. They're the quiet winners so far, right? Good. Okay. So, ab Hardy mein ladkiyan hi hoti hain sirf, haan? Again, okay. So, next is from your side, huh? No, I'll skip this question, sorry. Because I had one on voice. So, this one, question, whatever it is. This is a 45-year-old male with unilateral nasal obstruction and repeated nasal episodes of nasal bleed. And as you can see, that is the radiology of an MRI scan with the T1 weighted image. And then you see some stains, which are mostly eosinophilic stains. And also there's a positivity for IHC markers. And there's a little bit of mitotic cells also coming in. Can you guess what is this situation? 45-year-old, which decade of life would it be? I think the answers would be in that zone. Nasal bleed, not too much of pain or anything, no loss of eyesight, nothing, but a swelling and a nasal obstruction. Anything you can think of? There are not many guesses for this. So you can be louder. Sorry?
Pass.
This, by the way, it's not in the nasopharynx at all. Huh? Sorry, it comes from there. Sorry, it comes from there. Yeah. Team D. Pass. Team C. Cream. Do you see it in the? I think I'll have to give the negative. Right? Because it's not even in the. Where is the craniopharyngioma? Where does it happen? Craniopharyngiomas are in the nasopharynx. They'll hang in the nasopharynx. No, not in the nasal cavity. No?
B
pass. B pass? Okay. Take a chance. I think you're near it.
Cell lymphoma.
I didn't even know that answer. Sorry. It can be anybody. I don't think so. The markers are not for lymphoma. Yes, it's an olfactory. See, the side is from the cribriform plate, man. An olfactory or aesthesia, even if you had said a variation. It was very clear, I think, answer. But nobody answered, sir. Answered. Wow, I could feed the president also. Wow. Okay, so we are left with the one last round. Sorry. Polka dot appearance is in the black and white slide. Yeah. Yeah, we have still two more.
This was the first question.
I'm sorry. So this is the last round. After this, we'll have rapid. Okay.
Team D.
Actually, because I'll tell you why, since doing round three, is I made it for four teams, but now we have more teams, so it is showing it like that. Audience questions also are included in this one. So next question goes to
Team D.
This patient underwent an oculoplastic open surgery for a medical condition, resulting in this post-operative sequelae 2 days ago. See that? There's something coming out. See that? What is the possible condition of this? As you can see, look at his face, look at his everything. And what do you think is the immediate? He was my patient. Huh? 1 minute. You see that? He went in oculoplastic procedure. You want to take the chance? D? What is it? Well, that's not the prime. I said medical condition. Is CSF a medical condition? CSF leak is because of what? Okay, even if I ask, what is the medical condition?
Thyroid.
What thyroid? Sorry?
Thyroid.
Okay, then that's fine. I mean, do you see the eyeball proptosis of thalmo? This is the proptosis, no, bilateral exophthalmos. Where do you see exophthalmos? Malignant exophthalmos. Where do you see that? What is the single term for why it happens, malignant exophthalmos? Which is the condition? Which condition of thyroid?
Thyroid storm.
Thyroid toxicosis, right? Right. Okay. And what is the immediate ENT role? Immediate ENT role in this?
Decompression.
Immediate decompression. Well, I told you, he went in under and in oculoplastic. Do you think a thyrotoxicosis patient will ever have a CSFD just like that? Somebody must have poked something. That is why it happened. And what will the ENT or any physician do immediately? Will you do surgery? Conservative man, thank God. Yeah. Because he's already undergone a surgery, which called when you have a traumatic CSF leak, and that too from the superior by removing the lamina papacea, which is continuous with the fovea, and already the orbital fat and all is causing a little bit of the tilting of the bone, and you have a CSF, you have to make the patient rest, give diuretics, and IV antibiotics. And this guy, actually, I was also young like you, and I said we should operate, but I had a senior and then Dr. Grover and Dr. Rai, they all took the decision that we must make him lie down and see if it, and then he was already administered carbamazole and he settled very well in 4-5 days. So you have to treat the medical condition first. In any case, you do a surgery in a thyroid storm, give him GA, he might have a heart failure or something. So give the marks to them, right? They get the full marks, do they? No, they said thyrotoxicosis on prompting and they said conservative. So we'll give it. Okay. So next question will go to you, right? C. Which type of cell do you see in the scan where the asterisk is there? And what is this classification called? You obviously see this in that area. So it has to be classification of that area, please. Is the question clear? Okay, fast then. It's a theoretical, simple question. Sorry? Suprabula? Can you classify cells these days like this? I don't think so. I'm not a very well-known FES surgeon, but I don't think we can. Well, it talks about nothing. You have to tell me according to the classification. All right. Get the negative marks. Yeah, please. Next. But which type did you say? It's a modified type that we nowadays. It is not ABC these days. You have to tell me which type of frontal cells. Otherwise, I will not give you the mark. Marks. Where is it projecting? Is it only lower down or it's higher up that you can see? When you see the corneal scan, the axial scan is quite high up, and then you can see the sagittal. Why do we do sagittal? For one specific reason. Want to see the height of it. No marks, please.
Type 3 frontal cells?
No, it's type 2 actually, because a single cell is type 2 and many cells is type 3 in frontal rhesus.
So it is projecting less than 50% inside the frontal
rhesus. Frontal rhesus and into the sinus.
It's less than 50% is type 3.
We are following ABC or we are following 1, 2, 3? So they said which type? Type 3 you said. Well, it's actually type 2. Because it's a single cell. If it was a multiple, you would have said that this is type 3, no?
I think that's less than 50%
and more than. Are you sure? I can give it if the house is. So type 3, then you will get it. Okay? They get the bonus then. Right. That's okay. We have to learn from each other. It's a type 3 then. I just saw the scan and took the photograph. Okay, now this one I will leave. We have two more questions,
Yes.
You and you. Okay, sorry. Okay, no, this one also I'm leaving. Okay, what is Keytruda to you. What is Keytruda? And where is this term used? And you know, anybody knows about Keytruda trials? Anybody? Any idea? Will you have to come? Well, this is some, you have to read about new things in head and neck.
Antibody,
you're in the right zone. It's an immunomodulator trial that has been going, but which is the specific drug that we are talking about? Starts with a P. You know it? Batai. Yes, wonderful. And it's one of the biggest trials going on for head and neck immunotherapy in the US. I think you must read about immunotherapy trials. I will not give you marks, but I'll not also deduct also. So, pembrolizumab, a checkpoint inhibitor which checks the PD-1, PD-L1 pathway. We have to read about it these days.
Wonderful.
Yeah, one has to read immunotherapy research. Has anybody read about the CRISPR gene sequencing slicing trials that are going on? Such a huge thing going on in congenital disorders and prevention of cancers. There's a CRISPR, the book that you, which bestseller rahi hai, CRISPR ki upar jo book hai, must read now. It's not enough to be just doctors, you have to read what's going on. I remember, sir, in Sir's quiz, they used to, Dr. Mathugari used to always ask for publication spaces and all, and really, we don't have a three-dimensional view. That's why I put in the question about laryngoscope also. So where are we now? Do you? The last question now? Okay. Okay, which is this device? And there's a technology, it's a hint, it's called the PAT technology. What is this technology? Which is this device? It's got three parts, as you can see. But what is it used for? It's used by a lot of people in practice. No counting, please. Wait, console, yeah?
Apneograph.
Want to pass the answer? Question? You have to tell us about the device. That's simple. Pass. My God. Really? Nobody has used it? 1 minute. Okay, Ravi.
It's called sleep apnea. PAT stands for peripheral arterial
tone. So it's basically a watch pad device, and it does not employ the sonometry for the treatment. I was trying to guide you, but it was actually a misguide. But it is for assessing sleep apnea through a different technology called the peripheral arterial tone. Basically, they believe that there is change in your arterial tone when you are losing, it's almost 90-95% success rate for that. So nobody gets, I didn't know my quiz was that tough, but thank you, Ravi. Sorry? Watch pad device.
It's available in India.
It's available in India. Of course, it's a type 3, level 2 or 1. One ke beech mein aati hai because it can be done at home. It's not that reliable, but good enough. So this then does it for the tests so far now. And now we come for rapid fire. So rapid fire questions are going to be for each team. There are no negative marks. I could prompt if I feel like, if you want me to, if you keep on sticking to an answer, but the best way is not to stick it for long. Okay, but we can have the marks. So 5 marks for each answer and no negative marking. Even if they answer it 10 times wrong, they're just going to lose time. And should we give it 45 seconds? I think we have 20. We give it for 45 seconds. Huh? That'll give us time for 5 minutes. What do you think? We want to keep it for a little longer? Huh?
1 minute.
1 minute. Okay. I don't have these many questions. I'll be a little bit slow anyway. Okay. Can we start from team? Last time we started from here or there?
Sir, we started from Ames.
We are starting from you. Are you ready?
Sir, mass start. Start.
The artery passing through the foramen of Morgagni. Artery passing through foramen of Morgagni is which artery?
Pass.
Tensor palatine muscle is supplied by which nerve?
Nerve to medial pterygoid.
Nerve to medial pterygoid. Tensor palatine muscle. Fifth nerve. Which? Okay. I'll give it to you. Most common head and neck malignancy in AIDS is? Yes, that's right. Miller's muscle is found in which sensory organ? Broad sensory organ of the body. Miller's muscle.
Ear.
No, that's wrong. You can try again.
Nose.
No, that's wrong.
Next.
A patient with Sjögren's syndrome is at higher risk for which?
Lymphoma.
That's right. We'll give it to them because the question had started. Good.
They answered 3 questions correct. So their total score is 15.
Okay. So till that time, I would say that the first artery, which is obviously on the back of the throat and above, would be ascending palatine. The tensor palatine muscle, you said trigeminal, but it should have been mandibular branch. Well, that's a specific answer, mandibular branch. Miller's muscle is actually the superior levator palpebrae superioris muscle, and that gets paralyzed the sympathetic circulation. I should have asked actually the audience this anyway, and we can ask it next time. Then can we come to the next?
Yes, sir. Start.
Number of ossification centers from which the bony labyrinth ossifies. Main ENT manifestation. ENT manifestation of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. What are the ENT manifestation? Anyone? Tell me. Which are the characteristics of Santa's triad? 3 characteristics. Chalo.
Bronchiectasis. Aspirin sensitivity.
One more. Yes, there's something near the bronchiectasis, but what?
Bronchial.
Yes. Blue sclera is a feature of which congenital disease, which also causes deafness? Blue sclera. Name of the syndrome. Endolymph is formed in which part of the cochlear-vestibular apparatus? You can attempt that. I'll give it to you. No marks, negative marks. Which part of the inner layer forms endolymph? Anyone out there?
Stryovascular.
Give it to them. Okay, scalar media, but the membrane is
10 points.
2 questions correctly, so plus 10 is in this.
Okay, so anybody can tell me blue sclera is part of which syndrome? 1 minute. Who has not answered so far? I think, yeah. No, that is a part of the syndrome. Van der Hoek syndrome. You get this? Fantastic. But there is one more syndrome that mimics the blue sclera. It is not classically blue sclera. Sorry? What? Wonderful. And what else do you get in modern works?
Heterochromia, hair fall loss.
Sorry. Wonderful. And ENT manifestation of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. ENT, it's on the buccal cavity. Melanoplakia. Yeah, that's right. It's very significant. Very familiar. You bother. Yeah. Okay, where we start from you?
Team C.
Team C.
Ready? Start.
Which is the most common inner ear malformation? You know about all those ablasia?
Mondini.
No, it's not Mondini.
Communist. No, it's not Michael. Pass. Most common virus for congenital hearing loss. Associated with congenital hearing loss. Come on, easy. Sorry? No. Congenital hearing loss. Mother ko kya hota hai? Yes, that's right. First line therapy for adult severe sleep apnea. First line therapy for severe sleep apnea. Therapy. First line. Come on. Easiest question. Juvenile angiofibroma commonly arises from which site? Yes. Blanching of globus jugular tumor on compression of ipsilateral carotid artery is also known as. This is a difficult one. The only difficult question. No? Blanching of globus jugular tumor on compression of ipsilateral carotid artery. Its sign is called what sign? No. Well, that you will answer if you don't have any marks. So anybody can start from that. Blanching of globus jugular tumor due to carotid compression, not jugular compression. Jugular compression is different, I know, but carotid compression. Anybody? Well, it's called Aquino's sign. It causes a blanching, and then as soon as you release it, it goes away. And so first line therapy of adult severe OSA is CPAP machine. Come on, that even the CPAP guy comes and says, most common ear inner malformation, Michelle is common, but the commonest is Alexander, right? And did they also answer most common? Yeah, the varicella, they said, yeah, that's it. So good. No problem. Okay, can we come to the next one?
Team D.
Okay. Team D, are you ready?
Start.
Which is the most common malignant tumor of the submandibular salivary gland? No. No. Malignant, I said. Yes, that's right. Cricoid cartilage is derived from which arch? No. Yes, that's right. Corkscrew esophagus is seen in which condition? That's right. Name the famous ENT surgeon who also made it a big name in Marathi cinema and then subsequently Hindi film cinema. Again, try. Pass. Which sinus is called the sinus of Haimur? Which approach is the best for electrode lay in cochlear insertion? Which side is the best for electrode lay insertion? No. To the round window. So you don't get it. Right. Answer. Without. It's a round window, not anterior inferior. The lip and all has removal of the lip now is considered with inferior success rates. If you can get a good round window for direct insertion, that is the best. And other question was that they missed was which Marathi therapy? You were very keen. I think Dr. Mathur can answer, sir. Sri Ram Lalu, the person who was in that Gharonda and all, right? Always crying, right? But he was a great actor. So that's for you. Sorry. And corkscrew ho gaya, cricoid ho gaya, baki ko fit kar diya tha ACC. High more bhi tha, toh
chhod raha.
Four correct. Inter mujhe time zyada laga. Thoda theek hai. Let's start with the last. So this is the last one.
Start.
Who's the chief editor of Indian Journal of Otolaryngology these days? Currently. Pass. Okay. Lateral sphenoid recess CSM disease, Dr. Ravi's question, is due to persistence of which
tremor?
Okay. Right. Which is the major blood vessel supplying blood to the pectoralis
major flap, which is a major blood supply, chief blood supply. Okay, long segment tracheal ring stenosis in pediatric age group. What is the gold standard surgery? We all saw this thing today. Which is the long segment, I said. Complete ring, long segment. In children, pediatric age group. There's a very specific surgery now for it. Have you heard of the Cincinnati group? Have you heard of Michael Rutter? What does he do? Okay, anyway. Cernia classification for thyroid surgery, anatomy of identification of which structure. I got this question from this. Thank God. So you heard that at least. Okay. So long segment tracheal ring stenosis. And he's a, okay, we can say he's also a great proponent. He does it a lot. And Shashidhar, slight tracheoplasty, but you do not get it, you do it. So it will not give you a, okay. And major blood vessel supply to pectoralis major muscle flap, thoracoacromial artery, but which branch? Not ascending. Lateral thoracic, but wonderful. This is a question you get asked in vivas of exam. Okay. So I think that's enough, but I will ask one or two questions from the audience, if you allow me, because I have to finish 4-5 chocolates. Meanwhile, they can compile the result. A middle-aged obese man in a party has a sudden episode of blood vomiting, chest pain, and subcutaneous emphysema, followed by a collapse. Okay. Okay. Nahin, bhaiya, bahut khali mota ho jayega, kuch bachao. Okay. Rhinoscoridium severi belongs to which pathological class of organisms? Protozoa. Okay. Ortner syndrome is what? Who knows about Ortner syndrome? You do? Cardiac. What does it cause? How does the palsy happen? Then? What? How does it cause palsy? Of the left atrium. Who said atrium?
Okay, I have the. Oh, yeah, we bought it. Okay.
Sir, 50.
My God, no. Some mote will be. Okay. Cholesteatoma complication spreads through which the periarterial spaces. Who's the guy known?
Virtual. I mean, you have anyway. You need to. You've done the hard work.
Okay. Then a difficult question, maybe. According to me, I mean, I was a very average student. So,
so we have not talked about Indian Journal of Otolaryngology. Who's the chief editor? Anybody? No.
Lakshmi Namdev.
Yeah, you can get the chocolates.
And I think we should give chocolates to all of these. Huh? So that will be it then. And what is known as the Schneiderian tumor? Where does it arise from?
You know what? I wanted to keep this. Everyone knows this, but it was a short note in my DNB exam. And I didn't even know what it is all about. And I missed it totally. I thought I would flunk the exam. So that was, it has always been the Schneiderian. It looks like it goes to me whenever I hear this word. So thank you all. I think everybody enjoyed. We did well. Do we have a winner?
Team B.
Yeah, Olympus mein 5 baje ka AC band kar dete hain kya? Band kar dete hain.
Sir, aap itna bol rahe
hain. Okay.
Team B from LHMC is the first.
The team D has got the first prize, my God. And they were the silent ones. Huh? They were not answering that, but they took it intelligently. Who's the team? Second?
Team A from Ames.
Ames, you've done well. What is your marks?
30.
They missed out a lot of whists, but that's fine. But I must congratulate you. They topped in the prelims. They got 19 out of 24, right? And then we have third and fourth. Can tell the marks.
First is LHMC with 60 marks. Second is Ames with 30 marks. And third is MAMC with 25 marks.
Wonderful.
And team B and C?
Well, I'm happy that we could enjoy this thing. May the years be the same coming years, and I hand over the mic back to the organizing team. Thank you for letting me organize. This is the best part, according to me, of the conference. We hope to have more people next time, and I'll bring some more informals into it whenever we get the chance. Thank you. You did all very well. You knew better than I did. And I all rectified questions. Thank you.
Thank you. And may I have the names of the scorers?
Dr. Prakhar.
Dr. Deepika. You deserve a good standing ovation. Thank you.
Thank you, Munish. It was really fun. And really enjoyed your quiz. So we come to the end of the scientific session of Delhi AOA-CON. We'll start with the respiratory function. And I will invite Dr. Ishwar Singh and Dr. S.N. Mathur. Sir, please, sir, please wait for the award function, sir. Yeah, I invite Dr. Ishwar Singh and Dr. Mathur to give away the prizes for all the competitive sessions held in the 43rd Annual Conference of Delhi AOA. So we'll start with the temporal bone dissection competition, which was held at AIIMS last year, and the winners are Dr. Sabri Rajan P and Dr. Firoz Ahmed from Safdarjung Hospital. Just a minute, I give you certificate. So we have the best publication award. The best publication award is actually shared by two people. I was told that they are the two publications are the best publication. So the best publication award goes to Dr. D.K. Gupta from Army Hospital and Dr. Avni Jain from ESI Medical College, Faridabad. The Mukut Sari Award goes to Dr. Abhinav Agrawal from Maharashtra Medical College. Then we
have the poster award. The best poster award goes to Dr. Utkarsh Gupta from RML Hospital. Is somebody there from RML Hospital? He can receive the award on his behalf. Okay, good. The Anup Raj Resident Quiz Award goes to the team from Lady Harding Medical College. Please come. Dr. Sonali Malhotra and what is the name of the lab? Dr. Deeksha. Yeah. Next, the Raj SP Sony video presentation goes to Dr. Mahesh Ravanakutti from Army Hospital. The Junior Consultant Award goes to Dr. Deepika Chaudhary from Malara Medical College. Last award, that is the Senior Concerned Award, goes to Dr. Vikram Bhagwa from Lok Nayak Hospital and Associated Medical College. Somebody from Mulana Azad can take the award on his behalf. Okay, so I want to felicitate team from Olympus. I want Dr. Mr. Atif and Mr. Jitendra and Mr. Abhishek to please come on this dais.
Wonderful.
We'll
like the facility. Thank you. Thank you.
To be pain. That next year also it's better. Came then the lockdown. We will be catching. So I will let me know. It's not actually for me and Abhishek. It's Tarun sir.
Tarun.
It's our admin team who actually support us in every way possible. For the last 3 days, they are just this team is coming at 6 or 7 a.m. at this auditorium and all the IT support. And our IT person is there, he's regularly for the last 3 days.
Please come on stage. Thank you, all of us.
Thanks, sir.
I have a participation certificate for all the teams which qualified for the mains. So I would request AIMS team to first come and take participation certificates. AIMS team. Next, we can have team from Safdarjung, Maulana Azad Medical College.
Who was the third team?
Lady Harding was the winner. They have already
BMCC. Is there any other team left?
There was a team from UCMS also.
Yeah, please. Uh-huh. UCMS.
Okay,
and I would like to felicitate our quiz master, Dr. Manish Munjal. whoever has received the medals can take the empty boxes there, right? We have the empty boxes, so you can keep your medals safe in these boxes. Please take these boxes. And this comes to the conclusion of the 43rd annual conference, and I would like to call Dr. Taneja sir to please come on the dais, and Dr. Anand Mathur also to please felicitate our president of Delhi OI, Dr. Ishwar Singh. And last but not the least, I would like to keep my good memories of this conference, and I would like to get the memento from.
Thank you.
So I think it's now time to hand over the charge of president to the new incoming president, Dr. Harish Taneja, and and I would also like to invite the new secretary, Dr. Vipin Arora, to please come on dais. Thank you very much. So you want to say something?
I wish to thank you all for electing me unopposed, and I will try my best to carry the legacy of my predecessors, because they maintained very high standard for me. It's difficult to maintain, but definitely I will try my best and hope you will also support me and my team, and the past president, they will help me a lot. Thank you very much.
You also qualified, but we have to implement the guideline that we can have only one team from one. Thank you.